All right. So this is another paradigm shift. Sometimes healing happens in clothes like this. And then you're barefoot. So I, when I was told that I would be having the honor of working with you again right after lunch for movement, I said, uh-oh. So what do we do? Because when you get stressed, the sympathetic nervous system is activated. And when you're eating and digesting food, you really don't want that activated. You want to be in your rest and digest mood, right? And actually, your enteric nervous system, your gut, processes the food differently if you activate your stress response while you're digesting your food. So I really didn't want to cause harm to you guys today. When you get into active exercise, your stress response is activated. So I'm not going to do anything active with you, too active. I'm going to watch out for your well-being. And let's see, I'll put this here. And a lot of the things that I want to do are seated. But before we go on to that, and before we go on to meditations, I really would like to answer some of these beautiful questions you've asked me. I appreciate them. All right, so one question is, how is it determined that stress causes genetic changes? Could it not be behaviorally learned behavioral learning that leads to other dysfunctional behaviors? So the genes are a blueprint. Imagine that you're building a house and you have a blueprint. Someone has to get the materials, put those materials together to build that house. That blueprint is the gene. And your life experiences, everything that you have as resource in your body, proteins and micronutrients, they're the thing that is that's building that house. So if you're living in a certain stressful environment, let's say, the way those genes, that blueprint, comes to life is changed. And we call that gene expression. And in 2010, a study by National Institute of Health found that, at least in mice, glucocorticoids, the cortisol stress hormone that we all know, actually changes how these genes, this blueprint, comes to life. And those changes, the gene expression, goes on different into future generations. And this is called epigenesis. So whoever asked this question, if you Google National Institute of Health, NIH, epigenesis or epigenetic change and stress, you'll find really good articles about this. And they'll tell you that it's actually making you, your HPA axis, the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis, get aroused, activated more easily. So you're more susceptible to experience high stress from very small triggers. I also wanted to clarify something. I am an individual affiliate of National Child Traumatic Stress Network, and I'm honored to be part of that organization. Thank you very much for the nod. And I have worked in the development of some of these products that you've mentioned, and I'm, again, very honored. I provide trainings about traumatic grief, child welfare, trauma toolkit, juvenile justice tools that we have as NCTSN. But today, I'm not here as a representative of NCTSN. The research that I'm talking about is something that I've gathered myself throughout the years. Movement is my own personal, unique passion to build resilience. So I wanted to make it really clear, this is not, or this morning's presentation is not a product of NCTSN. All right, so another question that I got is, again, very good. Who should be making decisions about what innovations to try? Should it be part of an IEP? Should it be something for parents to be encouraged to seek out? So first of all, the things that I've mentioned today, they're not really that new. The neurofeedback has controlled studies from high-level, highly regarded institutions. But it's not covered by insurance. So if you're using government, any kind of insurance really, neurofeedback isn't going to be helpful. You'll have to pay for those individual sessions. EMDR is actually covered by insurance, and you can seek out therapy providers who implement EMDR alongside other therapies. In terms of movement, there's a new approach and actually a movement that's heralded by the National Academy of Sports Medicine and National Academy of Physicians in the United States, and it's called Exercise is Medicine. So that whole movement is really based on significant hard science. It's researched. You know, I'm not pulling these out of my pocket right now. These are not things that I found useful that I'm sharing just because I found them useful. A lot of people have found them useful, and it's been very supported by research. So those are the things I wanted to say, and I also want to mention that everything that I talk about here is an adjunct to everything else that we already have. Some of these, for example, cognitive therapies are still useful. The invisible suitcase is all about, you know, you overcome those items in your suitcase through talking and reflecting about everything that's happening to you, everything that you're feeling, thinking. That's cognitive behavioral therapy. And the other things, eating well, exercising, these are supportive of that therapy. Neurofeedback. I use neurofeedback in my practice before I do EMDR, for example, to get people ready to take in that therapy. And sometimes people don't want EMDR. They might just want to talk about things. That's how they're comfortable. So I meet people where they're at. And these are all different tools you have in your toolkit to reach out to at different times of your treatment. Everything is part of our life experience. We're very rich creatures in the way we respond to life stressors. So another question is asking for more clarification about my recommendation for diverse ingredients in our diet. I really passed over that topic very quickly. So I appreciate this opportunity to clarify. Now, when we talk about the gut microbiome, it's an ecosystem. Think of a forest, and all the animals, all the bugs, and trees, and birds, everything is part of that forest ecosystem. And the forest you have here in Alabama is different from the forest you have in Georgia, or the one you have in Turkey, or China, or Japan, whatever. And according to, again, studies so far, now this is a newer part of the science that I'm talking about, So far, studies show that the more diverse of a microbiome you have, the forest that you have in your gut, the more diverse it is, the better able to cope with attackers, microbes, viruses, bacteria, stress that you have around you. So that's why I recommended getting a diverse sources of food for yourself. When you eat fried chicken every day or a turkey sandwich every day, your gut biome, your forest, it gets to get inhabited with just a few species. And so far, studies show that kind of a forest is associated with problems from, you know, diabetes again, to mental health problems, depression. I don't know if you got a chance to read that slide, 90% of our serotonin is produced in the gut. And serotonin is all about fulfillment in life and feeling happy. Antidepressants are all about increasing our bodies, our brain's ability to get connected to serotonin neurotransmitters, the serotonin, selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, right? And then dopamine is also produced in the gut. 50% of it is produced in the gut. So dopamine is, of course, that joy, that satisfaction feeling, that motivator that gets us moving and doing things, wanting things. And if you eat right, you get all these things naturally produced by your body. So that's why it's very important. I wanted to suggest one literature review from the Pennington Biomedical Research Center at Louisiana State that was done 2 years ago. And its title is A Healthy Gastrointestinal Microbiome is Dependent on Dietary Diversity. So in that literature review, they're looking at a bunch of different studies that support this idea that diverse food sources are really good for you. So someone asked, how do I get involved with art therapy and how do I get information about body movement therapy? The kind of movement system that I've created isn't yet a therapy. I do this as a system of education where you get to explore your body and learn certain movements that are really associated with decreasing inflammation, enhancing your range of motion, and your interoceptive capacities. So this is what I do. In terms of movement therapy, you can just, and art therapy actually, there are organizations, there are fields that are devoted to these two things, dance therapy, and art therapy are their own fields right now. And you can get involved with those if you're interested. Some people have asked for PowerPoints. If you leave me your email, I really have been asked this in all the presentation that I'm going to. I want to create a little booklet that has the resources and little explanations about everything that I have here. I don't want to give you just the slides. So if you give me an email address, I'll email that resource or how to get that in 3 weeks. Give me some time to do this. 3 weeks. And if I don't give it to you by 3 weeks, you can email me back. All right, so some people have asked for therapists, local therapists, and alternative therapies that are implemented locally. Psychology Today is my resource to go for these things. If there aren't anyone providing these services, you can be the first one. Why not? You can get trained in them. Yeah.
People. The other thing is, we have a REACTS Facebook page. We can post some of this stuff so that people can find it. That literature review that you talked about, I could put a link up for that, and then maybe some additional places where you can go to look for the kinds of services she's talking about. We'll see about doing that in the next few days, so stay tuned.
Okay, that's a great idea, yeah. Someone asked, if there's such an effect of trauma on the emotional processing parts of the brain, why is there such a focus on thinking and not on emotions or this neurological, well, this nervous system, right? And this is a perfect, great question. I'm going to answer by saying it's partly culture, because we are living in a culture that puts high emphasis on thinking and the willpower. Some other cultures around the world, they're about singing, dancing together, you know, hugging each other, humming and singing. It's how they cope with stress. They don't really think of getting away from the community, isolating themselves with another person, and just talking about the things that bother them in that isolated situation. So this is a very cultural thing, first of all. Second of all, we really want, evidence-based practice requires some research background for whatever it is that we're doing. And I really support that, because you don't really want to be doing everything that comes to mind. Some people are actually doing that right now. They're going to, I don't know, energy healers, they're going to all sorts of practitioners who say they've got the answer. And it's a way to look for healing. I totally understand that. But when the government is supporting something and, you know, promoting something, they want it to have some research background. And I like to have that in my presentations as well, just to be, you know, somewhat secure in the things that I'm saying to you, that it's going to be possibly helpful. The third answer is, for the longest time, we really didn't have anything else. We didn't have an explanation of how this nervous system functions and what else we can do to help people. Now, we have this focus on process versus outcome. Today, the trend is going more toward biological explanations of the things that we're experiencing during trauma. So when you talk about biological explanations, you're talking more about biomarkers. Has the level of cortisol hormone decreased after your treatment or not? Have your inflammatory markers decreased or not? That's how more and more people are evaluating the efficacy of treatments. So that's kind of changing the way we approach things. Psychological approach to things is very vague. It's very, situational, context dependent. So it's hard to say something is definitely working or not at that point, or if it's going to be working in the 2 months from now. And one last thing, the cognitive behavioral therapies do help. They help in the short term, again, because of that brain thing. They're easily forgotten. So these are some ways that we can help those theories, that those treatments get retained more for longer periods of time. I hope that was helpful. I know it was a complex answer to that one. All right, so I think that's all the questions. Does anybody have any other questions? All right. So let's go on to the relaxation part of this. All right. So we talked about interoception, and I say that you can feel energy. And I'm going to actually show you by helping you experience it right where you're sitting right now. And you're going to actually experience your stress response system working. So in my opinion, energy is adenosine triphosphate, ATP. Your metabolism is all about creating energy tearing down molecules and then using energy to build up molecules, different molecules. That's what our metabolism does. And so right now, I want you to all relax and place both feet on the floor. And you might want to raise yourself up high on your chairs. I'm going to ask you to extend your arms like this, and let me sit down as well, just like you are. Just feel your palms in the air and feel how they feel when they're open, when they're closed. I'm going to ask you to make a fist on both hands, and I'm going to count to 10. At 10, I want you to open your palms. That's all this exercise is about. As you make a fist, I want you to notice how that feels, and when you open your palms, you're going to check out how that feels, okay? So let's go. Right, now squeeze real hard. Don't forget to squeeze as if your life depends on it, okay? You might be shaking a little bit. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Squeeze, squeeze. 9, 10, open. All right, so first of all, did anybody take a deep breath or exhale a deep breath when they opened their palms? Yes. So you're human. That's the stress response system working. And what happened is when you squeezed your palms, your muscles in the fists told the brain there is something going on here. We have taken the posture of aggression. We've taken the fight posture. So the brain got your heart beating faster. That's when you either started breathing really quickly, shallowly, or you held your breath. And when you opened your palms, your muscles gave the signal to your brain saying, coast is clear, we're fine. She was just, or he was doing a weird experiment. So your heart reset the body, and your heart helped you take a deep breath and helped you calm back down. You released that stress that was created in your fists. Now, you can do that exercise again to check. But if you remember, what was the difference between really squeezing hard in your fists and when you opened your fists? Did you notice the change in the type of feeling that you had in your palms? Yeah. So what usually people say is when they're making a fist, it kind of feels like it's not even there. It feels light and it feels like a rock, maybe, but when you're opening your palms, it feels heavy, it feels tingly, right? I don't know. Why don't you share? Who wants to share their experience? Did anyone experience something different? No one? No courageous volunteers? Okay, so then I'm going on. But please feel free to cut in and ask questions as I'm going through this. This is for you. I'm trying to make your time worth your while today. So what I call this is when you make a fist, the type of feeling that you had was a burning energy. It's a stress energy in your body. And actually what happens is you burn more, you burn more energy when you're stressed. And your body creates more biological waste when it gets stressed. And that's, I think, part of the inflammation problem that PTSD causes. So when you open your palms, your body automatically sends in the blood flow, it increases the lymphatic system functioning, and it tries to heal and remove those that biological waste that was generated during the stress moment. And it's trying to heal, bring nourishment to the cells that were damaged due to that stress when you were making a fist. So this is just you making a fist for a few seconds right there. Imagine your body experiencing this kind of energy throughout the day, throughout your life. So you need to figure out how to release that energy and send in that healing energy instead of the burning energy that I was just talking about. So this is a biological process. I'm simplifying by saying healing energy versus burning energy. I want to relieve myself. I had friends tell me, how does a self-respecting counselor talk about energy, something so woo-woo, right? But it's real. So this is what we're going to do today. I'm going to try to show you some movements that will help you help your body release some of those biological byproducts and help heal that those cells that you might have had damaged. All right, so one of my things is, let's go on to the second one. In fact, I'm going to have you stretch a little bit. So, everybody stand up on your tables. You look like you just ate a lot of food. Yeah, that's not good. I'm not going to get you stressed. I'm not going to get your stress response activated, but I am going to relax you a little bit. Imagine that the floor is potentially moving at any point of time, so you're really balanced, really rooted on the floor, okay? You're going to connect your fingers in front of you, and you're going to lift them up and push to the ceiling and push the bases of your palms as high as you can. Now, some people might want to actually also pull away those arms away from each other without unlocking those fingers, right? Okay, so this is what we're going to do. Now let me tell you about the breathing part. You're going to inhale and pull up and push. Hold it there. And hold a while. You might want to move around a little bit. Feel what your body wants you to feel. And when you're done, when you feel complete, you're going to bring those palms down, exhaling. All right? All right. So as you exhale, now imagine you're fogging a mirror and you're going to go, right? And it's going to be a fast exhale. So you're going to inhale and push, push, push. You might want to turn around a little bit, twist and do whatever your body wants you to do. And exhale as if pushing on something. All right. So So how do you feel now? Does your body want you to do something else? Maybe like this or maybe like this? Yeah? Do it. Somebody's dancing back there. Yeah. I'm all for that. I'm all for you listening to your body. Now let's do something else. Lift the base of your palm up to the ceiling and you're going to push it, right? Now, make a 90-degree angle with your hand and your arm. Yep. And this time, you're going to bring the fingertips up to your armpits. As much as you can, you don't have to really push yourself beyond your limits. This is very important. Keep it pleasurable. Now, imagine you're being pulled to the side by your elbow, right? And at the same time, you're trying to reach up to the sky, so you're being stretched in two different directions. All right, so that's what we're going to do. We're going to add to that a little bit. Let's do it with the other side as I talk about what you're going to add. If you can, push with your toe, big toe, on the side where you have the bent elbow, really hard on the floor. Push the floor with your toe. You're going to feel your leg engaged. Now squeeze that glute on that side. You're going to turn a little bit. And now, oh, do whatever your body wants you to do. And relax. Right? Now do the same thing on the other side. We try to stay balanced. If we do something on one side, we do it on the other side as well. Push with your toe, big toe, and your leg is engaged. Squeeze the glute, and oh, and. So if you're feeling like yawning, that's a good thing. Yes, please do yawn. Yawning gets the maximal oxygen into your brain, and that oxygen revitalizes your neurons. And the flow of the cerebrospinal fluid inside your brain, so you get those biological waste material removed. So yawning is good for you. All right, so now feel your body, feel your energy level, and see if it's improved just a little bit, or if you feel like doing something more, maybe. Okay, so if you feel like jumping up a little bit, down, that's fine too. And so far, that's it. I wanted to tell you something about my... Are you good? Do you want more? If you want more, I'll give you more. All right. So we'll do it later then. All right. So... A lot of us, when we think of dancing and moving, we think of how others see us. We look at mirrors. I'm completely against looking at mirrors. In fact, take mirrors out of your mind. When you're moving, move from inside. Focus your attention inside how you're feeling. If you ever do anything that I teach, never use mirrors. That's one thing I really, I'm very strongly emotional about. Well, not emotional, but I care about that. So here's a meditation for you.
Please take...
Oh, by the way, has anyone tried yoga? Okay, not many people. So has anyone from those people who tried it felt that it's kind of making them stressed out and feeling like they're going to burst or something? Okay, so it can happen with some people. And that's about the way the nervous system, the vagus nerve was activated, engaged when you were young, probably. And if that's the case, you might not want to do yoga. Instead, you might want to do more active sports or dance kind of thing. what happens is the stress response system has this mobilization, what we call fight and flight activation, type of activation, and it has the immobilization, the freeze kind of response to any activity. And when it gets into a posture, when our organism gets into a posture that reminds it of a certain type of activation, it can feel like we're in, we can get triggered. Okay? Everybody here knows what triggered means? When you experience something that reminds you of a trauma, that reminder takes you to the feeling state and physiological state of actually being in the moment of trauma. You actually feel like you're there. So in yoga, you stand still, and that can make your body think that you've frozen, or you've been held down, or you can't move. And that might feel like death. And so your body might react to that. And that's why some people, like me, I get really triggered by yoga. I used to get more. Now I'm better able to do it. But some people can get really triggered by that. And some people actually fight with themselves. They fight to go to the yoga studio every day and just do it in spite of their body, in spite of their feelings. You don't have to work against yourself. Keep listening to yourself, roll with yourself, support yourself all the time, okay? It's not a war, it's a collaboration with your body. All right, now let's go on to the meditation part. And if anyone feels like it's too boring, feel free to walk around. Don't worry, I won't be offended.
A deep breath. Inhale and exhale. Feeling the breath fill your body. Riding on top of the breath, riding it and freely letting it go as you exhale. As you observe your breath, feel that it has a rhythm. Your inhalation has a rhythm. Your exhalation has a rhythm. Your blood running through your veins has a rhythm. Try to feel this unique rhythm that's you in relation to the whole rhythm of the universe. Inhale and exhale. There's your breath. There's the breath of everyone. There's the breath of universe pulsing together. Inhale a deep breath, exhale, and let the breath go. Let it leave you with complete ease. Open yourself up to the new breath as naturally as you let the passing breath go. As you inhale, go to the top of your consciousness, as if on top of a mountain. Look down on the whole of creation. Take in the endless, open possibilities, organizing, disintegrating, and reorganizing in different ways. Drop any self-limiting thought. Stay here in your highest consciousness. Above all else, stay at the peak of your highest self. Let go of any self-limiting doubts, worries, fears. There's no lies, no betrayals, no judgment. There's no right or wrong here. Let go of all these thoughts and feelings. you may need to let go of the same thing many, many times. Keep letting it go and stay at your highest peak. Notice the joy of being blossoming inside you. Ah, accept the goalless playfulness of the universe. Welcome it. Welcome the joy. There are no goals here. There are no plans, no victories, no failures, no worries about who thinks what about you. Inhale deeply, slowly. Feel yourself rise higher and higher. Feel the pulsing of life, this joyful life moving through your center. And exhale. Breathe in, suspend your breath at the peak of your consciousness. That place in yourself which resonates the playful rhythm of life, and then exhale. Know that you've touched your highest consciousness today. You can find it again anytime you feel the desire. So enjoy, enjoy, enjoy life.
We are a community here. Our love for children, you know, our hope to make a difference in the world is probably some of the things that bring us together. And it's important that we take care of each other and ourselves and people around us so we can stay healthy. I think that's the one thing that I want to convey to everyone here. You're all very precious. And as much as you're used to giving all the time, giving of yourself, and it's very good to give, it's also good to watch out for yourself as well. Create some environments that are nourishing for you, filled with love, caring. And if there are environments that don't fit this, either change them or move away, because self-preservation is very important to help those kids that you're taking care of. But I think we all can, if we get together. Honestly, my work with trauma has taught me this. I didn't think this way before. I really believe love can conquer, really. It can conquer everything. And at the root of anything anyone does, that's great. There's love. There's love for, I don't know, some sort of a ideal, a person. But there's love there. So stay in a love-filled world that you create for yourself and for others. All right. Now, when your energy level is down right now, but I hope in a good way, on a scale of 0 to 10, how would you rate your energy right now? I have 8, 7, 5. All right, so keep that in mind, whatever you feel like you have. Now let's start building that energy back up, okay? Believe it or not, your fingers are very powerful tools. Yeah, wriggle those fingers, ladies and gentlemen. Wriggle away. And you can create your own rhythm while you're doing these, right? Now imagine you have a little jar of peanut butter, maybe, and you're holding it sideways like this. You're going to bring your two fingers in there and get as much peanut butter as you can from the lid, well, from the top of the jar. So you're turning this. And once you got that feeling of getting that peanut butter, can you imagine? Is it easy to imagine the jar and the fingers going into it? Once you get the rotation, you can take those two fingers out. You can open the other fingers. Now you have a rotation. Yeah. And you can have this hand teach the other hand how to rotate, just like it is rotating. Yeah, hands teach each other. Isn't it awesome? All right, so this might make you tired. Rotate the other direction. Wriggle more fingers. All right, so your energy is a little higher now, probably. Shake those up. You're getting higher, right? Stand up. I'm going to show you something fun, but this is a mega energy maker and releaser. So what you're going to do is, if you have heels, try to get them off, but yeah, or watch us do these. Heels aren't that good for this one. So again, you're in that rooted position, right? And place all your weight on the back of your heels so that you can even raise your toes almost. You don't have to, but it's almost there. So now what you're going to do is, in that rooted position, you're going to shift your weight from the back of one heel to the other heel, like that, and go as fast as you can. Now you're shaking, wriggling all your body, right? But we want to hold the upper part of the body tight. So imagine there's this table right in front of you at about this height. And you're going to root your palms onto the table, hold the upper part of your body stiff, and shift your weight. Yes, some of you got where I'm going with this. And shake really fast, and let your body figure this out. Shake it, shake it, shake it, shake it. Come on, guys and gals, everybody. All right, so if you do it, see, you're thinking how everybody sees you. Not good, not good. So you're breaking a barrier there. You're going to inspire others and yourself. And once your body figures out how to do this, it's very easy. And you can break a sweat doing just this. Okay? And it can release energy. It can build up energy wherever you feel like you need it. And shake those legs now. You've worked hard. How does your energy feel now? A little bit more, maybe? Okay. So now, while you're standing up, I think we digested a little bit. I don't know. Let's do I call this my happiness glide. So what we're going to do is really engage the tone the vagus nerve. That's the best word. We don't want to stimulate the vagus all the time. Vagus nerve is the nerve that connects our brain with the rest of our internal organs. So it's a very important nerve that we have. So find your shoulder joint. Place your finger on top of your shoulder joint. It's a ball socket kind of joint. Imagine that little ball there and push it to the back. And eventually start pushing back with your shoulder. Hey, what are you doing? I'm not moving. Yeah, and there's that dialogue. So feel how your shoulder feels when you push it forward and when you push it backward. Many people don't actually feel their body. They can't find their shoulder joints. And if they can find it, maybe you touch it and show them, they don't know what it feels like to move it. So this helps them find it and move it. So now place your fingers on the shoulder and move it back, keeping your hands still. See, there's this whole space behind you, and then you're moving it forward, right? Oh, it's getting tired. So let's take care of it. Let's be compassionate and loving to our shoulder joints, right? So do the same thing here, but this time it's quicker. You found it. You placed your hand on your shoulder. Move it back. Move it forward. Find your rhythm. Tuck, 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 whatever. This is my rhythm. Find yours. And then you can do it up and down. You can put a target, maybe about, I don't know, this high. I'm going to try to reach my hand with my shoulder. Oh, that's easy. I'm going to lift it a little higher. Ooh, I can't even do that. I'm awesome. Oh, now I'm starting to move my body. I want to isolate just the shoulders. So I'm not going to go that high. I'm going to stay this high. I can do that without moving any other part of my body. Isolation is important because when you isolate just one joint, you can follow how all the other parts of the body are responding to that motion. Interoceptive capacity, remember, we're building that when we do that. Okay, so now you can imagine you're pushing a pump on the floor as you lift and lower your shoulders. Yeah, and find your rhythm. Tuck, 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 tuck. Maybe samba, salsa, whatever you want to do, it's your shoulder. And you can do it forward and back. Imagine your table again. And you can put your fingers, your palm on that table and move your shoulders front and back. Well, back and front, back and front. Remember? A lot of people, when you tell them to do this movement, shimmy, shoulder shimmy, they do this. Yeah? Because that's our normal posture. So now to explore what you just did, how beneficial it is, kind of crouch, hang forward a little bit. Close your shoulders. Feel how that feels in your body. Okay, is it comfortable? How does your stomach feel? How does your breathing change? Now, open up, move your shoulders back. You can roll them up and back. In fact, you can open your arms. Who took a deep breath in when they opened their arms? Most of you, yeah. Because you're opening up your chest, you're opening up your heart, your lungs, you're getting more oxygen into your body. Does it feel good? Yeah. Yeah. When you do this, how does that feel? Does that feel good? No. Because you're closing your lungs and your heart require more energy to do the normal things that they're doing. So when you're doing this instead of this, you're getting more oxygen into your body, right? And you're stimulating the vagus nerve. Well, I said that again. You get what I mean, toning your vagus nerve. Okay. So I'm going to give you a song now, and you're going to use your new skills to move with that. Yeah. Okay, I forget the name of the song. Hold on, just 1 minute. Yeah. I have it in my cell phone, but okay. Sorry, guys. Shortyville. Get into the rhythm. One foot, the other foot. Find the beat and move with the beat. Yeah? Now, when you feel ready, find your solid space. You're going to start moving your shoulders. Dum dum. Dum dum. Dum dum. Whatever you want to do. Okay, all right, so what we're going to do is we're going to move with the beat, and you can do this seated if you want to, or if you want to move your body a little bit too, you can stand up. So every time we're going to find our own beat. Everybody is doing it right, however you're doing it, okay? There's no wrong way to do this. And you're going to find a beat in your mind, and you're going to follow that beat. So let's say I found da-dat, 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 da-dat. So every time it goes da-dat, I go like this, front and back. And every time it goes da-dat, da-dat, I go like this. Because that's the rhythm I have in my mind. Okay? You're going to find your beat. All right, so let's do it. And if you want to, you can wriggle your body too. Fun is healing. Laughter is healing. I can tell you of research studies that show laughing is good for you. Whatever you want to do.